What's up, everyone? It's Noah Daniels.
Hey, y'all. I'm JJ.
Hey, guys. It's Kat.
And we're your hosts of the Real Hauntings podcast. We bring on guests who share their firsthand encounter ghost stories and supernatural experiences. Now on to the trailer.
I've been warned to not tell this story, but I think because of the way it ends, it's okay to tell this story, because some people say that with certain entities, to like speak of them or talk about them or in any way like portray them as powerful will attract them to other people. The creepiest thing about it to me is a lot of times it would wait for me to notice it. Like, it would just lay its arm out like this, and then I'd be like, where is it, where is it? And then I'd see it, and then it would just slither back.
For more information on the Real Hauntings, Real Ghost Stories podcast, make sure you check out real.fm to learn more about our podcast and many other amazing podcasts.
Contained herein are the heresies of Radolf Buntwine, erstwhile monk turned traveling medical investigator. Join me as I study the secrets of the divine plagues and uncover the blasphemous truth that ours is not a loving God and we are not its favored children. The Heresies of Radolf Buntwine, wherever podcasts are available.
Subscribe on iTunes at Toddcast Podcast.
Oh my God. It's all happening. How are you?
Stewart Reynolds, thank you, man, for taking some time. I'm good. How are you?
Yeah, of course. I'm just fine, thank you. I'm just fine.
Nice. The internet's favorite dad. Dude, I love that. So good.
I stole that from Alan Thicke, you know.
No, really?
I did, yeah. I mean, like, not directly, but he had on his bio on Twitter, you know, before he was dead, was America's favorite dad, and he spelled favorite the Canadian way,
right?
And I thought, oh, that's a little bit of a wink and a nod, because he's America's favorite dad, but he's Canadian, right?
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, that's funny. And then when he died, I was like, well, I'm gonna steal that and make it internet's favorite dad and put a little asterisk and say unproven. Yeah,
of course. Yes. So how's life for you right now? COVID, I mean, we're pretty much at the 2 year point now, right? Like,
gone.
And it's good to see that you didn't die from your booster shot.
Isn't that awful? Isn't that terrible? What if, oh man, I mean, for, you know, to use, I mean, I expect people to sort of take, you know, pot shots at me, people who are anti-vax or whatever, to take pot shots at the videos and use them. It's like, whatever, I don't care. Hey man. And it's great when they watch the videos. It's like, great, that's a view. Fantastic. Yeah, when they used that one with that poor guy who actually did die of a heart attack, but not because of the booster, just a heart attack.
Right.
It's like, well, this is horrible. Like, that's bad enough and it's pretty tasteless. But at the same time, I had people who were coming up to me and be like, not coming up to me, but on Twitter, they'd tweet me and be like, is it true? Is everything okay? And it's like, I'm fine.
It's like, oh my God. Dude, I just had a friend, Bob Saget, of course, just passed, right?
Yeah.
And he posted on his, and I unfollowed him because of this. He posted on his Facebook wall some garbage account on Twitter. It was like a B0B Saget. So obviously it wasn't Bob Saget's actual Twitter account. But I feel fine after my booster shot. Like, what is the point of that?
I don't get it, man.
You do, like,
I don't get it.
How fucking done are you with COVID?
Exactly.
Like, everybody at this point is done. Like, I'm just done, man. 2 years is a bit much.
I know. I know. It's a bit much. And I think what's funny is that, you know, and you think about the like vaccine, people saying about vaccine mandates and stuff, right? Well, first of all, proof of vaccination. And when Quebec did recently the proof of vaccination for cannabis and liquor stores,
right?
And like, you know, even like myself, I was like, that's a little harsh. Maybe, you know, I understand there's people out there who need alcohol and cannabis, and like, meaning more than just most of us. And I was a little bit harsh, but then like their vaccinations went up like 400% the day the restrictions took place. Right. And then they more recently, when they did the thing where they're going to have a tax on the unvaccinated in Quebec. And it's like, I'm not comfortable with that, man. That's a slippery slope. And like, you know, private healthcare.
I saw that too.
And I don't, and I'm not into that. But then there were 7,000 appointments made yesterday because of the threat of it. Yeah. Wow. So it's like, that's the thing that drives me nuts. I think I'd have more respect for the anti-vax crew if they, you know, like if they were like the really loud tweets that sort of reply to stuff from of mine and you'll see elsewhere, and the Bob Saget tweet and all that kind of stuff. It's that notion of like, it's our principle. It's on, we're declining this on principle. Right. Oh, we can't get booze or cannabis. Oh no, I'll get a shot for sure. Or, right. Oh, it's going to cost
2 years
me
in.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, it's going to cost me an extra $1,000 a year. Oh, my principles aren't worth that much.
Right.
Like, shut up.
I know, it's insane. Like I'm an instructor at for the radio course at BCIT, and I'm driving to work yesterday, and they right now on campus, there's like a testing. It was at one point, it was the vaccine, but now it's just the straight up testing. It's virtually impossible to get tested here in BC.
Yeah. Yeah.
Dude, I swear to God, the lineup in a car, obviously, to get to this testing facility was like two full city blocks of a lineup just to get tested.
Yeah. Crazy.
It's crazy. Absolutely crazy.
Yeah. I mean, I had full sympathy for governments when the pandemic started. It was like, all right, this is a historic event. We've never really been in this situation before. Like those of us who are alive currently.
Yeah.
I've never been in this situation before. So what do we do? Like, let's figure it out. I know things are going to change by the day and all that kind of stuff. By the hour, things are going to change. We're going to get smarter. We're going to figure things out. But it's like 2 years in and you're like, especially here in Ontario, it's like, you know, they closed the schools for, they're supposed to open up last Monday. They're like, we're going to delay them by 2 days.
Like, what? What's 2 days?
Why? Yeah. And then, like, oh, we're going to delay it by 2 weeks. And then they said yesterday, oh, schools are definitely, kids are going back definitely next Monday. So like the 17th or whatever it is. Right. And it's like, what have you done? Like, what have you done in 2 weeks that you should have been doing in the past 2 years?
2 years. Time? Yeah. Like, yeah. I have a grade six and a grade four, like a two little kids, right? And
yeah. It must be terrifying now. Yeah.
And it just is like scary.
It's
just
It's totally. I mean, I think largely they're going to be okay. However,
yeah, I think so too.
It's kind of like if every single kid in the class had the flu and everyone at the grocery store had the flu, it's like, well, that's still like people still die from the flu. You know what I mean? Right. Like, there's a woman, Jill Permuli, I think her name is, on Twitter, and she has two kids, and one of her kids died from the flu. And she's a big proponent for flu vaccines and obviously a big proponent for the COVID vaccine, all that kind of stuff. But it's kind of like, yeah, we should take this seriously. Yeah.
I think so. Yeah. And also, like, what did they do in 1918? Like, they just let people die.
That's it.
Like, that's it. Basically.
I mean, what's interesting though, is I read a little bit about it, and they, you know, there was like mask mandates, essentially, like you had to wear a mask and all that kind of stuff. Right. So it wasn't too far off now, but generally, like, we just didn't have the technology, the medical technology, of course, back then. So people just died. What's really frustrating to me, I don't want to get off too off tangent here. Sorry. what's really frustrating to me is that, like, with the cannabis and liquor stores and, you know, essentially encouraging a 400% increase in vaccination in Quebec. Right. And then the threat of a unvaccinated tax driving 7,000 first dose appointments in Quebec. It's like, it really comes down to the idea that people don't care unless it directly affects them.
Right.
And even in the most banal ways of like, I can't get a bottle of wine unless I get a vaccine. Okay. I'll do it. I guess it's finally come to my doorstep, you know?
Yeah, I know. Right. Crazy. What, I can't get wine. No, hold up.
Exactly. I'll get that damn shot. This is serious. Oh my God.
Yeah. Dude, you're like, I'm tripping that I'm just even talking with you. You're like one of my favorite content creators.
Thank you.
I just love your sense of humor. Cause Thank some you. Of the, some of the, like, if you just watch your initial, like, first, maybe 5-10 seconds of some of your videos, it would seem like you're on the side of anti-vaxxers till you get to the actual point. Look, you're fish hooking them. Exactly. Who are some of your favorites that you like watching? Like, who are some of the creators that you're like, man, that's solid.
Oh, I mean, like, there's so many great ones. Like Sean Burke is amazing. Yeah. Rosie Holt is fantastic. Blair Erskine's amazing. Corey Forrester, Brent Terhune. I like Blair is really good at doing the hook as well. Like, she can play things off and people are convinced that she's on the other side of an issue. And it's total, like, it's totally ridiculous. And you know, I think if you just pause and go, no, this cannot be real. But and that's the same.
But I don't know that they have that, the brain capacity to actually work that out, that it's not.
No. Well, what's really funny,
you know?
Yeah. Like the, Rosie Holt, who's in the UK, she's phenomenal. And of course, there's a big stink right now with this, the parties that they had in lockdown at 10 Downing Street in Boris Johnson had and stuff. And, fantastically, he said, I walked into a party. I didn't attend a party or something like that. It was like, okay. Big difference. And, but Rosie does these things where she like cuts herself into these news interviews and plays up the most ridiculous aspects of the arguments that the politicians put forward. So she did one most recently, past couple of days, where it was like, I don't know if I was at that party. I don't know. And I won't know until the investigation's completed. Then I'll know. And then I won't even know if I've been investigated until the investigation's been completed. Then I'll know I've been investigated.
Right.
And so she had like people quote tweeting it saying, this is how bad it's gotten. This is disgraceful. This is like, how can this person? And it's like, she's not a person. She's not, this is just a joke.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. It's like,
yeah, totally.
Right over
totally.
Your head.
Would you
say you're a fairly political guy? Like, have you always had an interest in politics or no?
No, I hate politics. I can't stand politics. I think, no offense to the politicians I like, but I mean, politics is slimy. It's slimy, slimy business. And the worst part of politics is that I've been doing social media as a content creator for the past 9 years. And it is a slimy business. Like there's lots of amazing people and lots of lovely people. But you just have to realize it's like everyone's kind of jostling for profile. Everyone's always trying to make sure they're still, you know, getting attention.
Yeah.
And politics is like that, except it's people's lives on the line. And politics has never been, I'm aware of politics. I feel it's important to stay abreast of what's happening in politics because there are real world, you know, consequences to political stuff. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But at the same time, it's like, people have said to me, you should run for politics. It's like, no, I shouldn't because I don't care enough about people. I really don't.
My God. I couldn't imagine the shit that would be pulled up if I was to run for politics. Like, oh my God. No, thank you.
Yeah, I know we're not there yet. Right. Exactly.
So why Brittlestar? Why did you choose the name Brittlestar?
I chose the name Brittlestar. It was back in 2004, actually. And as you can see, this is my little studio area, and I've been making music essentially my whole life.
Yep.
And so in 2004, I was like, well, I've never made an album and I'm 34 years old. I better make one now. And before I turn 35, I don't know what that meant. So I made an album with help from this guy named Stephen Duffy, who's like one of the founding members of Duran Duran and worked with the Bare Naked Ladies. And he was currently at that time producing Robbie Williams' album. And we'd remotely go back and forth. And I really just like, I totally weaseled my way into contact with him because I've been a fan of his for a long time. And so it was great. I sort of felt like I'd been given a leg up already at that point. I was like, okay, great. I'm now working with a guy who's actually had, you know, a number one song, and he's had numerous top 10 songs. And this is exciting that he's written and worked on. And I thought, well, I can't release an album by Stewart Reynolds. That's dumb. Who's going to wear a t-shirt with Stewart Reynolds on it? That's not a cool name.
Yeah.
It's not jazzy enough. And so my eldest son, Owen, was 3 at the time, and he had a marine life book. And one of the sections was a section on starfish. And there was these starfish called brittle stars, and there still are. They have these like long spindly legs. They're really gross. They're the grossest looking of the starfish family. And they can see through their tentacles and they defecate out of their mouths like all starfish. And right. I was like, cool. I'll just take brittle stars and I'll jam it together and get rid of the S and brittle star. Make anything. And then, so I just had the band name and I released like 3 albums and 1 EP under that band name. And the first album did really well. And was licensed by MTV and all for TV shows and stuff. So it actually did well. And then when 2013 rolled around, I was like doing Vine. I was like, well, I've already got the socials, you know, I've got the ats at Brittlestar, and I've got the domain names. I'll just stick with Brittlestar. It's fine. I'll do that just for fun. And it just kind of stuck. And now, I mean, this is probably what the edge feels like. It's kind of like people just refer to me as Brit. Hey, Brit. Okay.
No, like, whatever. Don't call me that. No,
I don't care, man. Whatever. Stay on brand. It's cool.
What's the music in the Reynolds house as a kid growing up then?
Oh, well, my parents are Scottish, so you can guess. If you've ever seen So I Married an Axe Murderer, it's very, very similar to that. A lot of Bay City Rollers, nice. A lot of Beatles, a lot of Elton John, and a lot of Rolling Stones. My mom and dad's first date was a Rolling Stones concert. Nice. With Ike and Tina Turner opening. Yep. And so I mean, it was all sort of the classic 60s rock, along with some real heavy cheese, 1970s cheese, with the Bay City Rollers, which is fantastic. Exactly. So in our house, there was like a, you know how people get lyrics wrong and they sort of mess them up?
Yeah. Like, excuse me while house, I kiss this guy.
Exactly. Exactly. Yep. Or Alex the Seal, all that kind of stuff. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And in our house, the Bay City Rollers Saturday night, where they chant S-A-T-U-R-D-A-Y night. And they do that.
Yeah.
My dad's chant was S-A-T-U-R-D-A-Y Saturday. It's like they don't just say Saturday really fast at the end, they say night.
Oh my god. What was your first concert?
My first concert ever. Well, if I want to just really broaden the definition, my first concert ever was Mr. Dress Up in 1970.
Did you see Mr. Dress Up? Nice.
Yeah, 1975. Casey and Finnegan were there as well. I saw him again. So I saw him when I was 5, and then I saw him again when I was 21, but Casey and Finnegan weren't there. Some other discount puppets showed up. It wasn't really as good. But he did make a Milli Vanilli joke, so that was pretty good.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, which is nice. I mean, that was my first concert as such. And then I think my first big concert was at Maple Leaf Gardens, and that was for The Clash. And
oh, wow.
That was exciting. Yeah. Yeah.
That's a pretty good. It's pretty good bar to set right out of the gate.
Right?
Flash,
it's,
right?
It's got way more cachet than I merit. I think it makes me sound cooler than I am. It's like,
yeah, I know, right? Clash. You should just, dude, next time you get asked that, just fucking lead with The Clash, you know? I'm trying to get Raffi on the podcast. Love to talk to that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
He's the coolest, man. He's awesome. Yeah. He follows me on Twitter, and I'm always stoked whenever he interacts with me, I'm like, ooh, this is exciting.
Yeah, I know. Every once in a while, he'll like one of my tweets.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, Raffi just liked my tweet.
And he's badass too, eh? Have
he's
you been
pretty badass, man.
He's very badass, and he's like, he's a very much an activist and all that kind of stuff. It's great. I love it. Yeah. It's fantastic.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. Most overrated band on the planet.
Oh man, that's a good question. The most overrated band on the planet, according to me, is, oh God, that's a really tough question. The first band that popped to mind was U2, and U2.
I'm right there. I like U2 as well, but I'm right there with you. REM, Smashing Pumpkins.
I've never really been into Smashing Pumpkins. See, sort of lost me because of like my age and where I was and what was happening in my life and stuff. I didn't get on the Smashing Pumpkins into the grunge train of like the early 90s. I was kind of like aged out of that a little bit.
No. How many? I'm 48. How old are you?
52.
So you got me by 4 years. Really? Maybe you just missed it then.
I worked at HMV as well. Nirvana's Nevermind came out when I worked at HMV. It was an amazing album, phenomenal album.
Yeah.
But I was never into like Soundgarden. I was never into I hated Pearl Jam and all that kind of grunge stuff. I just really wasn't into it. And then I actually, in 1993, in the height of grunge, I really got into this album by the guy I did my first record with, Stephen Duffy, who did an album in Abbey Road with Nigel Kennedy, who's a classical violinist, but kind of a wacko dude. Yeah. And so I went totally the opposite direction then.
Wow.
So, yeah.
What are you binging lately? Binge watching?
The Great which is a phenomenal show on Amazon Prime. And it's very crass, but it's very funny. And we've been watching, of course, all the classics like, you know, Succession and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And of course, we're now excited because we're watching The Righteous Gemstones again, which is an amazing show.
Oh, dude, that's such a great show.
And I've only made it through 2 episodes of Letterkenny so far, but I'm excited because there's a bunch of stuff I'm enjoying watching.
Yeah. I mean, watching that, there's a something on Disney. Is it Disney or is it Netflix? I think it's Disney, where Will Smith is, I think it's called Welcome to Earth or something like that.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
If you haven't seen it yet, it's really well done. Like
excellent.
He travels around the world with like, adventurers and just does like cave spelunking and whitewater rafting and like goes underwater, goes to the bottom of the ocean. And like, amazing. It's just really well done.
There's more cool stuff on Disney Plus than you realize. We've been watching as well. One of the other things we binged was The World According to Jeff Goldblum.
And another really fantastic. Good series, right?
Yeah. It just makes you, I've been touching my chin more since I've been watching. And
yes. I wonder why are you a fan of all the superhero stuff that gets made in the last 10 years? Like Batman and Justice League?
Not really. It's not horrible. I mean, it's not horrible. It's just really, I find it really funny because it's one of those things where there are things that just don't click with me. And that's the superhero films just have never really clicked with me. I mean, I really enjoyed like way back doing like some of the Batman reboots. It's like, well, that's fun. I like that. The first Spider-Man movie that came out in 2002 or whatever. That was cool. I like that. But then like, it just doesn't like the Infinity Wars and all this is too much stuff happening for me.
I was just going to say, maybe it's just like, there's just too much content coming out.
There's a lot of content. And then plus I think there's a lot of activity on those particular shows, those movies. It's like, there's so much stuff happening on screen. It's like, it's too much for me, man. It's too much.
Yeah,
and it's just like that and video games just for some reason have just been like, just past me. I don't know why. I try. I just can't get into them. Yeah.
Worst job you've had?
Wow. The worst job I've had. Oh, there's a really good answer for this. I know there is. I've been pretty fortunate. I've had some pretty good jobs.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's the worst job. Like I've been like, I've been a carpet installer. I've worked at a record store. I've been a record store buyer in the UK. That was a fun job. I worked in a toy store as an adult. Worst job though, I think would probably be like one of my first jobs, which was, that's not really that bad, but I worked at a lottery and cigarette kiosk, lottery and smokes.
Like a Sheffield and Sons.
I don't know what that is, but maybe like right it's in the middle of the wall.
A little kiosk. It's got lottery
right
tickets.
In the middle of lottery tickets. Exactly. Yeah. So that was my very first sort of actual job. And it was fun when you shared a shift with someone. But and like my first shift at this lottery kiosk, someone won a Lincoln Town Car. That was exciting. Okay. Like on a scratch ticket. And they're like, wow, you're lucky. But then it got sad because then you'd see the same people coming every day, every shift, you'd see the same people coming in to buy lottery tickets
just
and to buy
wasting
smokes.
Their money. Yeah.
Wasting their money, getting ashen every day. Like, just like it was like, oh man, I don't know. Like people used to come and buy, instead of like, you know, give me that scratch ticket. That's what they'd say. Give me a flat of the blah, blah, blah tickets. And they would give you $2,000 and they would take a big flat of scratch tickets away. And they would do that every week. And they'd come back and they'd say, well, I've got this one and this one. And some weeks they would get $5,000 in winners. Some weeks they'd get like $50. It was like not a very good business model at all, but it was depressing for me. And then you get the people standing in line behind them going, yeah, can I get some more Benson and Hedges, please? I need another carton of Benson right away, Mrs. Absolutely.
Yeah. That's a rough gig. All right, Stewart, I'm going to wrap this up in a couple of questions. I told you I need maybe 15, 20. We're past that now, so thank you.
Yeah, no worries.
Thanks, man. Are you a big fan of sports? Like, are you watching the Montreal Canadiens? Are you watching the Toronto Maple Leafs? Are you a fan of, like, UFC? What gets you going for sports?
I'm a fan of playoff sports. I think I have a hard time. I have a little touch of maybe like something like an ADHD. I'm not going to say I have ADHD, but I think well, I have a little bit of that. Well, probably. Exactly.
Yeah, I think we all do.
I think that sort of working for myself has kind of made me think I should probably be doing something else right now. So I'll watch like when the Raptors were doing really well, I'll watch those games for sure. When the Leafs are doing well, I'll watch those games, but I'm not really a big sports person. And I've never really been a big sports person. And I think that was probably by the fact that I wasn't allowed to be both. You couldn't be a new wave spinner with your foundation and lip gloss and amazing bangs and like sports. You just had to pick one or the other. You had to pick one or the other. And I picked bangs and lip gloss instead.
Yeah.
And, I did a thing for ESPN once for March Madness, and I pitched them. They said, we want you to make a script for this video that you're going to do. And I was like, great. So in the script, I had to list off a scene where I had a list of the teams that were competing on like a chart to go down to who's going to win. And they wrote back and they said, first of all, none of those are actual teams. that state, not even in it. And that those aren't real names. And I was like, oh, okay, well, you better tell me who's at, what sport is this again? That's my relationship with sports.
Right. Right. All right. Final question. Share a near death story with us. Where you're like, holy crap, man, I could have died there.
Well, you have just walked into my trap by asking that question. When I was 19 years old, I fell off a 70-foot cliff. And I bounced twice on the way down and landed on rocks that were about the size of watermelons, roughly like decent-sized rocks that were being used to start building a road. And like the foundation of a road. And my face was ripped open from above my eyebrow to my mouth, my lips, and on the left side of my face. And they sent an ambulance. The ambulance strapped me in, and then that ambulance got stuck. No. So they had to send a second ambulance for me, and they strapped me in and got me back to the hospital. And then just by luck, the surgeon who was running the ER, he said, listen, I'm actually interning for plastic surgery. I can give you stitches. You'll have a scar from your eyebrow to your lip, or we can do like, I'm using this fake tissue and we can actually do plastic surgery on you. And that you won't have a scar except for a small one up by your eye, which I have a small scar up by my eye. And, I was like, okay, let's do it. So that's probably there's been lots of times in the car where I'm like, whew, that was close.
Yeah.
But I think falling 70 feet, I was like, when I just right before I blacked out, I was like, that's it. That's the end of this. Wow. I've had a good run.
How do you fall off? Like, so tell us the story, the lead up to falling off. Like, how did that happen?
So this was in Goderich, Ontario, which is Ontario's west coast, which you people in BC can laugh at. It's on the coast of Lake Huron, and it's beautiful. And we were renting this house. Well, my girlfriend was renting this house. And the night before, it was right there. There was just bluffs off the end, the backyard, and then just bluffs. It was straight down. Gone down to the water. Gorgeous. Amazing. But obviously dangerous. This is now evident. And so the night before we were out and we saw this boat come into shore, which is a really quiet part of the beach. And like, not really, you couldn't really get to it at that point unless you came by water. And this boat came in with a light and we saw someone meet them on the shore. And then the boat took off. We're like, huh, it's like a drug deal or what's going on here? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. What's happening? So we thought, well, it's too scary to go down in the darkness. Let's not do that now. Let's go down tomorrow morning. So we all went to bed, and then it's myself, my girlfriend, and a good friend, and we didn't go to bed together. We had separate. There were two sleeping arrangements, and we got up in the morning, and then headed to the bluffs. And you could get up and down the bluffs, but if you kind of like really leaned into the cliff and walked diagonally down, you could kind of zigzag your way carefully, hang on to trees and stuff on the way down, little bushes and stuff like that. You could kind of get down.
Yeah.
And I was the first to go, and I took one step and I was like, oh shit, I've lost my footing. And then, so I took, instead of smartly, I would have, if I was smart, I would have leaned into the cliff and just dropped to the ground. Like, okay, reset, try again. But instead of doing that, I tried to stand up on the cliff and take another step to catch my footing. And I didn't. I did. I took one step and took a big step and then took another step. And I was like, nope, that's it. I'm no longer touching the ground. And then I just free fell for, I guess, 70 feet and then bounced twice at the bottom. And then to make matters worse, my girlfriend and my friend both successfully zigzagged down the cliff to see if I was okay and came over to see me. And when I turned my head over, I said, I'm okay. It's like one of those things where you're in shock. And I was like, yeah, I'm okay. I'm okay. And apparently my skull was showing and my girlfriend threw up. And this woman who happened to be going along the coast was walking on the coastline, actually ran over and put a cardigan over me, and her cardigan must've been ruined. I don't even know who she is, but yeah, exactly. So that was the lead up to my cliff story. And the local newspaper, Goderich is only not a town of 9,000 people. Local newspaper ran the headline that week, which was alive, but bruised, because I took up every ambulance for a day.
So yeah. Wow. And so how did they get you up then?
Well, they came along, like they drove the ambulance on these big sort of rock foundation that they had. So there was like big boulders and then there was like smaller rocks. I'm sort of showing like the size of a melon roughly. And they were kind of being stacked and formatted down. Like it was all fairly tamped down. And the idea was they're going to put gravel fill and they were going to put sand in and they were going to put asphalt on top of it. And it's now a lovely road. If you drive down there, it's a lovely road now.
Yeah. Nice memory.
No, yeah, great memory.
That's where I almost died.
Exactly. And they just backed the ambulance on and it was like slowly, but the first one got stuck in the rocks. And then they had to send a second one, which was further. So they sent the paramedics over, put me on a stretcher and then walked on the rocks, wobbled over to the ambulance and stuck me in the ambulance. So, yeah.
Crazy.
All right, there you go. See,
well, glad that worked out, buddy. It's nice to,
me too.
Nice to have you on the podcast.
Thanks for having me, man. I appreciate it.
Yeah, you're easy to find at Brittlestar, both on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Easy to find. And also Brittlestar.com.
That's right. Yeah, Brittlestar.com is the sort of, if you really want the boring information, you can go there. Or if you want a full blow up size picture of me for your bedroom wall, you can also get it there too. So
nice. If we send that in, we can get it autographed.
Sure. I'll sign anything. Sure.
Awesome. Stewart, thanks, man. Have a great day. And see you online.
Take care. See ya.
The Toddcast podcast on toddhancock.ca.
Listening to a podcast should be time well spent. And I promise it will be if you'll give this podcast a try. It's called Something You Should Know. I'm the host, Mike Carruthers, and in every episode, I talk with leading experts on topics I know you will find fascinating. From why people can't keep secrets, what your favorite music says about you, why your pet acts in strange ways, and so much more. Something You Should Know is designed to give you information you can use in your life and give you great intel that you can share with others. I'm told it's a binge-worthy podcast. And with over 1,000 episodes, there's a lot to binge on. Something You Should Know has been ranked in the top of the Apple podcast charts consistently for a long time. I know you're going to like this. I just need to get you to try it. Something You Should Know. It's available wherever you listen to podcasts.
Hi, this is Rob Benedict.
And I am Richard Speight. We were both on a little show you might know called Supernatural.
It had a pretty good run, 15 seasons, 327 episodes.
And though we have seen, of course, every episode many times, we figured, hey, now that we're wrapped, let's watch it all again.
And we can't do that alone. So we're inviting the cast and crew that made the show along for the ride. We've got writers, producers, composers, directors, and we'll of course have some actors on as well, including some certain guys that played some certain pretty iconic brothers.
It was kind of a little bit of a left field choice in the best way possible.
The note from Kripke was, he's great, we love him, but we're looking for like a really intelligent Duchovny type.
With 15 seasons to explore, it's going to be the road trip of several lifetimes. So please join us and subscribe to Supernatural then and now.
Do you love Disney? Do you love top 10 lists? Then you are going to love our hit podcast, Disney Countdown. I'm Megan, the Magical Millennial.
And I'm the Dapper Danielle.
On every episode of our fun and family-friendly show, we count down our top 10 lists of all things Disney. The parks, the movies, the music, the food, the lore. There is nothing we don't cover on our show.
We are famous for rabbit holes, Disney-themed games, and fun facts you didn't know you needed.
I had Danielle and Megan record some answers to seemingly meaningless questions.
Oh,
I asked
no.
Danielle, what insect song is typically higher pitched in hotter temperatures and lower pitched in cooler temperatures?
You got this.
No, I didn't.
Don't believe that. About a wish coming true? Well, I didn't either. Of course, I'm just a
cicada.
I'm crying. I'm so sorry,
Jiminy. You win that one.
So if you're looking for a healthy dose of Disney magic, check out Disney Countdown wherever you get your podcasts.